And thank you for those of you who moved down to the front. I so appreciate it. Good job. Wait, I forgot to put my thumb up. I'm nervous because we only have less than an hour together, right?
9:15.
9:15, great. Well, that makes me a little less nervous. So the reason I get nervous is that I love this program. I've been doing this since it began. And I love what Dr. Huber does, and I love what you do as clinicians, and I love the kids that you serve. And that's a lot of love, isn't it? The great Yogi Iyengar said, "I don't teach you, I love you. The love will teach you." I like that. I also don't believe in teaching. Most of the teaching that I've seen in my career as a student was bullshit. These people were on like tall ivory towers that are very precarious, and I don't consider myself any more than like a fly speck, if that. I love Mahatma Gandhi, where he says, you know, all he wanted to be was a hole for the power to come through. And so I kind of hope, I wish that for myself, that I could just be a vacuous hole for the power to come through. That would be great. So teaching, when people say, "Oh, you're a teacher," I kind of cringe, because I would rather consider what I do is setting a climate where people can learn. And that's okay with me. I also like what Rumi said in 1250, the great philosopher and poet. Anybody read Rumi or anything by Rumi? The Essentials of Rumi? Well, you need to ruminate on that, I think, but that's where that came from. Rumi said, if the student fails, we should beat the teacher. You like that? Do you teachers you'd like to beat? And I teach healthcare administration, so would that apply to healthcare administration? I mean, when for instance, a doctor came out and said, "Gee, we just lost your mom on the operating table," wouldn't it be great just to pop them in the face? But what if it's a woman doctor? So I try and ask questions that will help people think and perhaps learn. Yeah, independent learning, to me, is paramount. When I was lucky enough at BU to meet Malcolm Knowles, who was the father of adult education. Part of the problem is they use the term pedagogy, and it comes from the Greek stem child. And we think in terms of teaching children, which you folks are doing, and that's great, but it doesn't work for adults. Those methods that we use, so he coined the word andragogy, andros from the Greek word adult, and he actually had a fight with Merriam-Webster, the dictionary company, and finally got andragogy into the dictionary. So I'm kind of, I'd like to consider myself more of an andragogue than a pedagogue, because you're not children. And to andragogy, really appreciates your experience, your life experience. I mean, I can guarantee that you've all been through a lot more than most anybody realizes. I teach a course called Disability with a question mark, because I don't know what the hell disability is. And the longer I teach that course, the bigger that question mark gets. But I used to have one of the assignments at the beginning of class, I'd say, write 1,200 words about a loss that you experienced. And I don't do it anymore, and in part, it's because I'm 64, I can't take it. I can't take the pain and the honesty that students, sometimes for the first time, they wrote something that they knew wasn't going to be corrected with a red pencil. And for instance, Stephen Pugori was a freshman. He'd only been in school for a week at Stonehill, and he wrote a 1,200-word paper about what it was like 3 weeks before school started to be teaching on a Saturday morning, about 1 o'clock in the afternoon. His little brother had just asked if he could borrow his new dirt bike, and he heard a screech of brakes and looked out, and his brother had been just run over by a pickup truck and killed. And he ran downstairs, and his brother was dead, his little brother, And one of the first things he did was get the hose to wash the blood off the street because his mom was due home soon and didn't want her to see that. And the police grabbed him, threw him down, banged his head against the street and said, "You can't do that, you're destroying evidence." And he had to later pull his mom off his little brother's body. And this was in a 1,200 word essay that came a week later when he came to class. He passed it in. And nobody at school knew that Michael had just lost his brother 3 weeks before. It was overpowering. And senior year, we had a senior retreat, and Michael read that essay. And I bumped into him at South Station the other day. And he's married with three kids. He's a healthcare administrator. And one of the first things he said to me was that, to this day, that assignment remains one of the best assignments that I ever had in school. It was the best thing I ever did. It was the beginning of me being me and being able to take what happened and turn it into strength. And I love when that happens. So we don't have much time together, and why I get nervous is I think, you know, I don't want to waste your time. I always worry that I'm not going to be able to meet your needs. And so here we go. As Joe says, have a good time. I think any time you learn is a good time. It's not always fun. I love education. I actually, one of the things about Stonehill that I love is that that's where I found my wife. I married a student. I walked into the classroom and she was sitting like three seats back in the middle, and she was talking to a guy from VMI over in the, I still hate him. But I looked at her and I said, "Wow, she is hot." You know? And I actually started dating her before the semester was over. I know it doesn't happen often, but I met her a week after the class was over. She turned 21 and invited me to her house, and I met her parents, which was really tense. That's always, you know, when you meet anyway. So, do you think that's okay? One student asked, by the way, what did she get for a grade? She got a B. What was your question?
Same thing. What grade did you give her?
Good for you. And thanks for asking the question. And I like the way you did that, and I'll come back to that later. But that's, I like your attitude. That's great. Yeah, she got a B. That's all she deserved. Well. And maybe if she'd done more in the class, she would have gotten a higher grade, huh? So you think that's okay? Another student once asked, well, how old were you when you met her? Suppose it was 10 years ago. I'm 64. Suppose I was 54, and she was 20, obviously. She turned 21 a week after the class was over. Is that okay? So what about this idea? Yeah. Or how about if I was 28, right out of grad school, and she was 20? Would that be okay?
Yeah.
No. It wouldn't be okay at all, because you're thinking that I was her teacher. And I never said that. I said I met a student at Stonehill. It was 1964. I walked into the math class that I had to retake because I was so bad in math, and so was she, and we were both transferring schools. I lived in Stoughton. It was a summer class. It was figured it would be easy. Not only was it easy, and I also got a B, but I met the woman who ended up being my wife for the last 40 years, and I'm so glad about it. And I went home that night. That first night of school, when I laid eyes on her, I went home and I said to my parents, now I'm a year younger than she. She's an old, I married an older woman. A friend of mine once said older women are grateful, but I think that's awful. But at any rate, it was fun when she turned 50, for instance. So when she turned 60, I said, gee, you're a woman in your 60s married to a man in his 50s. I'm only 11 months older. For 1 month, we're the same age. But I remember I went home and I just, you know, my parents said, how did it go tonight? And I said, I think it's great. I love the teacher. And oh my God, there's this woman in the, I sat in front of her in class, and she's awesome. About 10 years after we were married, we were having dinner with my mom and dad, and my mother said, you know, the night you went up, you came home and you described her, you went upstairs, and I turned to your father and I said, he just met his wife. How do mothers know shit like that? I don't understand how they know them. But I set you up like that because I really believe that the classroom should be a place where people think, and I want you to analyze everything, not just that I said, analyze everything. Look at things from all kinds of directions, like a jewel that's multifaceted. You gotta walk, turn that thing around and look at, and question everything. Question everything. It would be absolutely unforgivable for a teacher to hit on a student, especially during the class. That's like you're in a position of power and you have to respect that and you have to, that's not what it's about. And the fact that many of you just so easily fell into that trap of saying, yeah, it's okay. I like the fact that right away when I said the age, she got audible and I'm out of hearing. I wear these things, you know. What? Yeah, I heard you. Okay. Yeah. So the fact of the matter is, though, she may just be ageistic. She may say, well, at that age it would be wrong, but I didn't check that up. And I like your altitude, so we're not going any. I just like the fact that you were uncomfortable with that and expressed that. What I'd really like is for some student to say, you know what, I think you're totally inappropriate. That would be great. I appreciate that. And I like the dignity and the grace with which you behave. My concern is that sometimes we need to be rude. When for instance, I had a student who ended up becoming a physical therapist. And he called us 7 years after he graduated and said, because of your class and disability, I just got fired. And I said, tell me what happened. Congratulations, first of all. Because, you know, he was calling me and he was calling me for support, obviously. I said, what happened? He said, they asked me to drag a half-dead patient up and down the hall so that they could bill for the patient, and the patient did not need therapy. And I spoke to my supervisor, and he said, you have to do it. And I spoke to the administrator, and they said, I don't think we need you here at this facility, and I just got fired. So in addition to finding him a much better job within a week, we also helped him report the facility, because they were doing this all the time, and it was welfare fraud, and it was also abusive to patients. And my concern about being concerned about being rude, and yes, I like it, and I try not to be rude, although sometimes I say things like shit. But I also own a farm, and it's a perfectly good word on the farm, you see. An old lady once said that to me. I worked out west. I was like a cowboy 2 summers out west, and I came in with my boots on, and she's 86-year-old, very intelligent, erudite woman, and she said, don't come in the kitchen with shit on your boots. And I was kind of surprised by that. And she said, it's a perfectly good word. You're on a farm, you know. And I learned it was true. It was everywhere. My concern is that if we don't speak up, terrible things are going to happen. Howard Zinn just died this week. Howard Zinn was at Boston University. He was accused of being un-American for almost his whole life. He spoke out against the Vietnam War vociferously. He spoke out about all kinds of things that were wrong, and he taught all kinds of people to do that. And now, if you read all the obituaries by Alice Walker, for instance, wrote an incredible obituary about Howie. She called him. They were good friends. He really was a huge, huge tool in the civil rights movement. And probably will continue to be, even though he died. But he was considered un-American. At Stonehill, when a month after 9/11, Winona LaDuke came and spoke. She's an Ojibwa Indian. Anybody know heard of Winona LaDuke? She ran for vice president in the Green Party with Ralph Nader for a couple of terms. Didn't make it. Too bad. She has 2 degrees in environmental science, one from MIT, the other from Harvard University. Is that the name of the school? Yeah. She's a real slug intellectually, obviously, but oh my God, what an incredible powerhouse. And Winona, you just don't mess with Winona. And when she came to speak at Stonehill a month after 9/11, it was in October of that year, she was running for president, though she had run for president in the last, vice president in the last election. She said, President Bush and President and Vice President, that was a Freudian slip, Vice President Cheney had taken Nixon's energy policy and just dusted it off and reintroduced it, which was absolutely correct. And to prove that, she had read a letter from the Department of Energy where they found the largest seam of coal in the country in Mount Rushmore, and they were going to drill into Mount Rushmore. Anybody seen Mount Rushmore? Anybody here? Oh my God, it's so beautiful. And the head of the Department of Energy said, drilling will not affect the faces of the presidents and it won't affect the visiting center. And Winona said, forget about the fact it's a holy mountain for the Blackfoot Indian. And she said, I always wondered what was in the head of an American president, but I don't think this is going to tell us. And 500 students got up and walked out. There were maybe 20 people left in the hall. Everybody got out and walked up. And it was during dinner, almost, it was, she was running over, so it was like dinner time. And I thought, God, they must be awfully hungry. And the next day in class, I said, why did she walk out? And they said she was unpatriotic. Well, she wasn't unpatriotic. She was absolutely right. And they finally stopped the drilling. She was on her way to Clinton, Massachusetts. Anybody from Clinton? That Clinton is a small town in the western part of Massachusetts. They had the best Indian museum in the nation. And the reason they had such great artifacts is one of their native sons was in the Battle of Wounded Knee. And after they killed all the Indians, he stripped them all of all their clothes and all their jewelry and their weapons and put them in trunks and sent them up to Massachusetts, sent them all home as souvenirs. And it's a huge collection. And consequently, they had this incredible museum with these actual true artifacts. And the law was passed that you had to return artifacts to different First Nations, and the Indians, it was also Blackfoot Indians in that case, they tried to get their artifacts back. And the people in Clinton said no, the Historic Commission, and they said no, we're not sending it back. So they asked Winona if she would help. You don't want to mess with this woman. She is one tough Indian. And she wrote them a letter and said, I'm sorry, but the law says you have to return these things, so you must return them. So I'm looking forward to not only hearing from you, but getting the artifacts back. And they wrote and said, well, we really can't do that. And she wrote back and said, you really can. Obviously, they would have to go to court about it. And they wanted to avoid that. So they said, they wrote her back and said, we think we know a way around this. We want the museum to continue because it teaches people about Indians, and we like that, and we think you would like that. So if we send all of the things back, could you have your people, that's actually the phrase that they put in the letter, could you have your people make copies of everything we send back so that we can continue with the museum? And I had dinner with Winona the night before she went out to actually meet with the people in Clinton, and I feel so sorry for those people. But she wrote a letter back saying, I think we know what you need, but we had one clarifying question. Do you want the clothes with the bullet holes or without? Don't mess with someone like Winona. She wasn't as concerned about, and it's not a criticism of you, please don't think that, but my concern is that sometimes, because we don't want to be rude or we don't want to speak up, incredibly horrible things happen. How many people have a Toyota? Or in their family is a Toyota? Yeah. Good luck. How many have had it fixed recently and told it was okay? Yeah, it isn't. I guarantee it isn't. And I had one young woman who said, oh, they just replaced the floor mats and told me it's okay. She's still driving it every day. And that it's horrible. So it's important to speak up, because if we don't, things just don't happen. And creativity is something that I really feel a lot about. And I have a senior level course which is entitled The Creative Process. And I was lucky enough to, 4 years ago now, AUPHA is our accrediting organization, the Association for University Programs in Healthcare Administration. And it's a good sized organization, and I was shocked to find that I got an award for being one of the three best classes, the class did, I did, one of the three best classes in the nation to promote change in the healthcare system. Which is so stupid, because why would anyone want to change the healthcare system? It's so great. God, there's no health and no one cares. And no one's speaking up. And so the first thing is I want my students to speak up. I have a disabled student who, not a student, a friend of mine, who actually was a patient in 1974. When I was in grad school, I did a clinical affiliation at Lakeville Hospital. And I was being toured around by this woman who was not a healthcare person. She was like a volunteer director. And there was this little Chinese kid in a wheelchair, and he had aphthitoid cerebral palsy, and he's all over the place. And I said, what's the story with him? She said, oh, he's profoundly retarded. He'll never leave the nursery. He probably will choke to death because he can't even swallow. They have to feed him with a syringe. And just as she was saying that, I watched his little hand shoot out, and he lifted up a nurse's dress. My God, I love that. I don't love lifting up nurses' dresses, but you know, if my wife were a nurse, I would. But I just thought, my God, this kid is not retarded. He's a normal, obnoxious 13-year-old boy, and I was right. I said, put him on my caseload. And I was halfway through grad school at that time for psychology, as an adolescent psychologist. So I'd had courses in intelligence testing and had worked with a psychologist who had modified intelligence testing, Goldstein-Shearer test and things of that sort, that you don't need to have verbal stuff going on. And I pegged him at about 138 for an IQ. And psychology later corroborated that probably higher. He's a genius. And nobody, they thought he was a retarded person who could not even swallow and was going to die. And they were just pretty much waiting for him to die, keeping him alive. It was a good hospital. They did some incredible things, but they were wrong about Peter Wong. And I finally, after a while, could understand what he was saying, and he said he didn't want to be fed with a syringe anymore. Two nurses would hold him down, and they literally squirt a syringe this big of food, gone, done, dinner's over. And he hated that. And I tested him for central reflex testing by holding him in different positions and stuff. And he was showing 5-month prenatal reflexes. 5-month prenatal reflex. How do we know that? Because there was a neurologist named Tom Twitchell, which I think is so weird for a neurologist to have a name Twitchell. But at any rate, that's what he did. I worked with a pastoral counselor whose name was Paul Fagg. Imagine that. He had to either be a prize fighter or a minister. I don't know how you... But, I couldn't tease him because my name is Warren Dahlin. That wasn't easy to grow up with. But at any rate, Peter was incredible. And this article by Tom Twitchell said if you take a fetus, probably before you abort it, if you take and probe the cheek with a glass rod, the head will turn away, or if you touch the lips, its mouth will open and its tongue will stick its tongue out. And this happens at 5.5 months gestation. And I just can't even imagine how they did these experiments. But having said that, the information was quite valuable because now, as an occupational therapist, I can do central nervous testing. Even an adult will show sometimes persistent reflexes from prenatal period. So, and he did. He had all the same. If I touched his cheek, his head would turn away. If I touched his lips, his mouth would open and his tongue would protrude. And if I put his head up, or if he looked up at me like I'm looking at you, Kathleen, just walking up, as I walk up to you and your head goes up, his hands would stick out. So a lot of nurses thought he was fresh because every time they'd walk up to him, his hands would go out, and sometimes he'd hit strategic spots, you know? And he wasn't trying to be rude, he was just being Peter. Although he did definitely try and lift that nurse's dress up that day. But anyway, I worked with him for, by that time, I'd read an article by Bass Madron saying that if you used cold or ice, you could subdue all reflexes. There was another occupational therapist and neurologist, Margaret Root, who said if you took, they working with polio, it was a polio epidemic in 55, a lot of people had bulbar polio. We had a whole room of people in iron lungs at Lakeville where there was a positive and negative pressure in a tin can, literally, with a rubber collar around the person's neck. And when you sucked out the air in the can, they would breathe in, and then it would make them breathe out. So nowadays, of course, we don't have to do that. We have other machines and methods. But Margaret Root took an ice cube and rubbed people's next to the intercostals, rubbed their ribs three times, three strokes here, three strokes here, and the person would start to take a breath. And she found that that had a persistent effect, so that it actually helped some people who had problems with inspirational capacity. And so I had, those are the only two articles that I saw on this business. And I asked my supervisor if I could try using ice with Peter. And she said, and nowadays this would be totally illegal, because you have to, if you experiment on human subjects, you have to go to the human resource committee in the hospital and the school. You have to do all kinds of, you have to have literature that shows it's going to work before you try it. And you can't treat people as an OT three times a day because there's a cap on services and the government wouldn't allow that. So none of this would have happened now. But fortunately, we didn't have to worry about any of those rules because it didn't occur to anyone in those days. But I took ice, and I actually made, he loved grapes, and so I made purple, like, ice cubes, and I would rub around his orbicularis oris, the lips that you use for, the muscles to purse your lips for activities like whistling, you know, and then on the masseter, the muscles used for chewing, and was very careful not to let any cold water drip down on the neck, because that would innervate another cranial nerve. And I just wanted to put all kinds of stimulation back into this part of the brain that hadn't really developed yet. And even at 13, his little nervous system was still plastic. You're working with these kids who, you have no idea how much you will be helping them. I do have an idea how much they help you. For some of you, this program is a real epiphany and will change your life. Especially if you end up having a kid who has some kind of a disability. I hate it when people, you know, when my wife was pregnant, and she's 5 feet tall, so when she was pregnant, you could see her coming around the corner, you know, long before she got there. She was gorgeous. She looked like a ripe fruit. And I loved it. And she loved it. She would stand and just like, and then after the baby was born, she kept going like this. But people would walk up, total strangers, and say, oh, you're pregnant. Obviously, you know. Well, you have to be careful saying that, because I know a woman who had a tumor, a fibroid tumor, and people would come up and say, oh, you're pregnant. She said, no, I have cancer. I was like, whoo! Sorry. You know, I can't count the number of times people would say, do you want a boy or a girl? And well, nowadays, people say, oh, do you know if it's a boy or a girl? Because, and you know, it's one of the only surprises in life left. I don't know why people, and if you know, then people are going to buy all blue stuff or pink stuff, so don't go there. And my daughter just had a baby Friday, and thank you, Jesus, oh God, I was so excited. And she didn't want to know. And people were like, you don't want to know? Why would you want to know? What a surprise. When little Colin popped out, and he did pop out, she was in labor half an hour. Strong woman. I love strong women. Dude, we need to. I like women with power tools. I mean, I think, call me crazy, but the fact of the matter is, we've got to take care of kids. With Peter, I used this technique, and every day, three times a day, I would rub the ice, three strokes here, three strokes there, in the hopes that he would suck. I was going to make a bumper sticker recently. I was thinking, babies suck. It's true, and you want that. The first two reflexes you get when the baby comes out, the first two obvious ones, are the rooting response and the suck reflex. And he had neither. The rooting response is that the kid's looking for the nipple. It's like, where is it? It's somewhere here, I know it is. So if you touch a kid's cheek after they're born, the stimulus causes them to go directly to that spot. And once, if you introduce the breast or your finger, immediately the kid will start sucking. So those two, in fact, I know there are some guys in college who still have that involved. But at any rate, and those that are laughing are probably the ones I'm talking about. So they say you can't laugh at anything until you have a person involved with it. But the fact of the matter is, Peter had none of those responses, and he needed to develop that for us. So we needed to subdue the oral reflexes. Hopefully ICE would do that. I worked with him three times a day for a whole month. My affiliation was over at the end of 1 month, and he was scheduled to go to a pediatric nursing home in Billerica. And my God, I put a little, by the way, I made a wand for him and a head wand, and he started typing. I modified a typewriter so that it had slots, so it was easier to purchase the point. And within no time, he went through 8.5 grades in like a month. Brilliant kid. 766 had just been passed that September, and we got him into school, and he just flew through school. In the meantime, unbeknownst to me, he was going down to the OT department, and he was glazing with his, they put a paintbrush in it, and he glazed this beautiful ceramic frog, and they fired it, and he did that, so he wanted to give me something when I left. What he gave me was incredible, far more than that. And so the last day, I figured we'll do it the last day, because if it doesn't work, I can just squirt out of there and nobody knows the difference. Well, we put a little cup holder in his wheelchair, and he just sat there, and this was another thing. There were no such thing as large diameter straws. You guys are so lucky. You have all these large diameter straws. That didn't exist up until 1974. They were all paper and thin, and it would take, you really had to work to get the fluid up there. But they were fun, you know. In elementary school, you used to squeeze the bottom of it, and then when you go to suck up, the straw would implode, and you'd get milk all over, you know, the person. McDonald's was brand new, and the first one was in Middleborough, in this whole area of the state. And one of the nurses that last day was nice enough to go down to McDonald's and get the first large plastic straw I'd ever seen. God, we've come a long way. And we put it into his cup. And it was clear plastic, so you could see the fluid. And we're all standing around, and I said, give it a try, Peter. And he put his lips on it, and his lips didn't open up. And he started to draw up the fluid, and you could see it coming up and up and up. And all of a sudden, he went, and he sucked up a whole mouthful of water, and his eyes just opened as wide as a Chinese person's eyes can open. And he just sprayed water all over everybody. And that was the last time in his life he was fed by a syringe. From that day on, he never had to be fed by a syringe. That was 1974. Peter's in his 40s. We are very dear friends. He sells ice water in front of the Ritz-Carlton Hotel. From his wheelchair, in front of the Taz, and he's like an institution. The quack buses quack at him, you know, the viaduct, yeah. If I want to know where he is, I can ask any of the Hawkins, where's Pete, and they'll say, oh, he's down on Boylston Street, or he went home for lunch. He's pretty amazing. I lost contact with him. He took me downstairs, gave me this beautiful frog, which we had on our mantle for years, and we live on the other side of Great Hill. And when Ingrid was 6 years old, she was dancing with a broomstick one day in the kitchen. My wife wasn't commuting to work that day with, and I'm kidding. So, you know, broomstick, which is not. God, you guys, it's early, I know. So Ingrid hit the frog with a broomstick, and it went flying frog, landed on the brick floor in our kitchen, just shattered. And I just went, oh my God, I wonder if Peter is okay. I thought about him all the time. 18 years after I met him, we had Spanish kids staying. We did every summer. We had Spanish kids staying with us, and you would have to bring them into Fenway Park for a ball game. And we were all in there, sitting there, and the Spanish kids were fun. They said, "What is wrong with you people?" And I said, "What are you talking about, Monse?" And she said, "Well, nobody is watching the game. When in Spain, when we go to a game, we watch the game. You people are doing the waves, and you're buying the hot dogs, and drinking the beer, and looking around, and you're not watching the game." And she was absolutely right. You got to look at something through the eyes of people who are different, like the kids you work with. And I was like everybody else. I'm looking around, of course the ADD helps, but I'm looking around and way up, like 50 rows up, is this Chinese guy with altitoid cerebral palsy. How many Chinese people do you know with altitoid CP? I only know one, Peter Wong. And I said, "Oh my God, I think that's Peter. I'll be back." And I walked up where he was sitting, and I walked over to him and I said, "Peter, is it you?" And he went, "What?" And we never had forgotten each other. And it's, had an old lady was a board member years ago, 89 years old, amazing woman. And Margaret taught me so much. And she had been at her best friend died. Best friend was 90 years old, and friends all their life. And the woman died, and Margaret went to the funeral that morning and came back to work. She was a volunteer, was a board member. Lots of work to do, she said. "I'm on the finance committee, we had lots of stuff to do." I said, "Margaret, are you okay?" She said, "Oh, I'm fine." Had a great, great service. All the hymns she loved, good eulogy. It was dandy. I love the way old folks talk. It was dandy. I don't know what's dandy about it. And I said to her, what was she like, your friend?" And Margaret looked into space and she smiled lovingly. And she said, "She was like someone you'd put on a gold chain and wear around your neck. And for the rest of my life, I've had this invisible gold chain. You get one today. I wish I could give you a real gold, but this is even better. Because on that gold chain, there are people who have changed your life, or who have taught you. People like Peter Wong was on my gold chain. Joe Hugh is on my gold chain. Many students. People sometimes that I lost my hair when I was 16. I felt like a toad. At 21, my girlfriend, Michelle, my wife, had broken up with me. Every time I told her I loved her, she'd break up with me, so scary. And I was like, really feeling like a toad. And I was on the subway, and I was admiring these three guys on the subway, all had like awesome hair. Makes me puke, you know? And because I was bald literally at 16. I did a hairpiece for graduation from high school. I was wrestled with a guy in a senior year, and he grabbed my hair, and it all came out with his hand, and I pinned him, which was great. But Dr. Huber makes me vomit when I look at his beautiful hair. It's still great, you know? And so, and I've been teasing him about that ever since we met. But the fact of the matter is, this woman, I was on the subway, and this hot-looking woman got on it. I got on a Braintree. She got on it at the next one, Quincy Adams. And I'm sitting there feeling really sorry for myself, thinking, "Oh my God, I am like such a loser, and I look like such a toad, and I will never find anyone who will love me. Oh my God, I don't go nowhere, so I don't do nothing." You know, and I'm looking at these three guys saying, "They've all got a chance, and I've got no chance." And we got to South Station, and she was gorgeous. Oh, she was beautifully dressed, she was reading a good book. Her hair was beautiful, I mean, she was just. So she got up, she was happened to be getting out at South Station where I was getting out, and to be chivalrous, I let her go ahead of me. If truth be known, I just wanted to check out her ass, but at any rate, that's normal, so, sort of. And so she walked by me, and then she stopped, and she put her hand on my chest, and she said, "You know, my father was bald. I love bald men." I stood there. I looked over at these three guys who were like, "Oh, shit." And I will never, it was an epiphany. It didn't occur to me that there might be some woman who liked it. And there were two. Michelle and this woman. And I didn't even get off the train. I was so stunned. I missed my stop. And, you know, I'll never see her again, but I will be forever grateful. She's on that invisible gold chain. And Peter rolls into class now. He helps me teach this disability class. He rolls into class, and I absolutely, pardon the expression, shit all over him. I say the worst things. This was his idea. I'm not this, like, I'm not that smart. Peter said, we got to get this across to students. But he's got it in terms of setting a climate where people can learn. And he rolls in and I do attendance. And he still looks very young. He could be a student still. And he's got good hair. Oh, God. Thick, beautiful, black, straight Chinese hair. It's not good on me, but it's okay. Hair and so Peter rolls into class and I say, I do attendance. I don't call him because he's not a student. I don't lie. And he says, I said, is anybody I didn't call? And he goes, he's talking worse than he usually does. And I said, well, you obviously are Peter Wong. You're the only Chinese person in the room. An awful thing to say. And I can't say that, of course, if there are other Chinese people in the room. However, that doesn't usually happen in Stonehill. We used to be the whitest college on the Eastern Seaboard, but we're doing a lot better. At any rate, Peter then, I start telling the story. I said, oh, I have handouts. This is great. I don't know what it is, but I had everybody change their seats. And this is part of the reason, because I knew I was going to tell the story. There's always a jock sitting in the corner seat where you're sitting there, but I had everybody move around. So there would have been a jock sitting up in the I don't know who writes the manuals for you people, but you always read them. Peter and I have done this 21 times, and he's always there for us. The other thing is there's always an attractive woman sitting in the front row, and usually in the middle. I don't know, where do you guys read the manuals? How do you know to do this? And Peter, now, when he goes in the classroom, he looks there and he looks there and he bursts out laughing and people think he's having a seizure. I mean, I once tickled him and he flew out of the wheelchair. That's how much spasticity he has. But anyway, I have handouts and I count the people in the class and I take away one handout, so I'm one short. And the poor man in the last seat, the first handout, I go to give Peter and his arm goes like this. And I say, well, do you want it or not? And he says, yeah. And I stuff it down between his leg and the wheelchair. It gets all wrinkled up. And you would think that students would say, wait a minute, that's not right. That's what we're looking for. No one ever does. 21 times, we've never had anyone, including one class where half the students were nurses. Never has anyone stopped us. The third handout, I'm one short. I know that. And the poor guy in the back, I feel sorry for him. But he raises his hand, he said, duh, I didn't get one. So I said, no problem. And I go over, Peter's like over on this side of the room, I grab the last handout, smooth out the wrinkles, walk all the way around, and hand it to the poor guy sitting in the back. And I would like for that guy to look me in the eye and say, first of all, what you're doing is totally inappropriate, and I'm leaving the class and I'm going to the dean right now to report you. We would love it if someone did that. And they never did in 21 times. And then this is where the woman in the front comes in. I start telling the story I just told you, and in the middle of the story about, I say, this is why this class is here, because of this little boy that I met in 1974. And it doesn't occur to anybody that he's sitting in the room, say. And I say, well, halfway through the story, he said, oh, I'm thirsty. I said, what? He's thirsty. So I said, well, did you bring anything to drink? And he says, no. Terrific. So I take a dollar out of my pocket. There's vending machines across the room, across the hall. And I tell this poor woman, here, go get him orange juice. Now, you have to teach people you don't give disabled people choices. This would be very wrong, right? I'm tongue-in-cheek. I'm not serious here. And I know he doesn't drink orange juice. So he says, no, apple juice. I said, okay, apple juice, orange juice. I don't care. Just get him anything and just come right back. So she goes, the poor woman, and she gets the apple juice, brings it back. It's in a can. I said, thank you. And I go around and I where Peter's sitting. Now, the next thing we want to teach people is you never design buildings that work for disabled people. You have to make them as uncomfortable as possible. Heavy doors, lots of steps, is wonderful. And all of the desks are tipped in the classroom. So here's my buddy, and I put down the can, and I go to rip off the tab. And he says, no, no, no. I said, now what? No, you have to push it up halfway so that when you put the straw in, which he has in his backpack, it'll perch so that it doesn't move around because he has so much plasticity. And so I said, oh God, all right. So I put it there. Now I'm back up the front of the room telling the story and everybody's staring at him. They're all watching him because the can is slowly moving down. It's going south. Then, have you ever seen someone smoke a cigarette when the ash is so long and you're just waiting for it to drop off? And you don't listen to a damn thing they're saying because everybody's concentrating. It's like that. The can is right at the edge. We wait till it's right at the edge. This is his idea. That's the reminder. It's right at the edge, ready to fall off. And I look over, and everybody's aware of it, most people. And I said, wait a minute, stop for a second. This isn't working. Mr. Wong, you're going to make a mess. You're going to spill everything. Will you please come up here? And I wheel him up to the front of the room where I have a table. Now, will you please just drink your drink and not interrupt again until I finish the story? Still, nobody stopped me. And then, now people are really staring because he's at the front of the room. And when we used to call people on it. We used to say, did you notice how you were staring at him? And frequently, students would say, we weren't staring, or I wasn't staring. So Peter said, one semester, next time we do this, will you set up a video camera on the class? And so it was perfect, because the student said, we weren't staring. I said, oh no, look at this. And we pushed a button, and there's everybody gawking at him while he's drinking out of the straw, which is fine. He knows that happened. At the end, I say, the reason that I'm here and the reason he's here is that I can't teach you, but we can only set a climate where you can learn. And he has something to ask you because he is the 13-year-old boy that I met in 1974. He's my dear friend, Peter Wong, and he has something to ask you. And Peter rolls out into the middle of the room, and in the best speech he can muster, which is a stretch for him, it's hard, he looks at everybody for a minute, and then he says, why didn't you stop him? I have no answer for that question. I still can't answer that question. For years, Peter and I have been trying to answer that question. In part, it's because people want to be polite. It's in part because you're afraid to speak up. You're afraid of being un-American. What could be more American than speaking up? It's a democracy. I don't know how I teach that class without Peter. I have to look at my notes. I notice you, Angela?
Lisa.
Oh, the person you're working with is Angela.
Yes.
That's great. I noticed you folding your arms. Just keep them folded. I want you all to fold your arms. You already have your arms folded, Michelle. No, you're Ariel. And you have, okay. You have your right arm over your left arm, and you have your left arm over your right arm. Are you both right-handed? There's no correlation between arm folding and the way, and cerebral dominance. And I just want you to fold your arms for a second and keep them like that. I'm just talking now, just to waste time while you get used to your arms being folded. Because I'm going to ask you to do something right now. And that is, when I say go, I want you to switch. Don't do it yet. Think about it. Switch directions. So if you're right over left, I want you to be left over right. And I want, when I say go, I want you to look around the room and watch how people do this. This is an exercise in habit. Ready? Go. Okay, and we still have people working at it. We have people who are... talk about motor morons, you know? The other thing that happens is that people go like this. They'll go, oh, I can do that. This is not this. This is twiddling your arms. And what that is habit. And habit is a huge block to creativity. The first assignment in my creative process class is you have to go at dinner and eat with a total stranger in the cafeteria and not tell them it's a class project. And they just sit down with a total stranger and they have to document the process. I tell them that. And the next day, from the next class, I say, okay, pass in the papers. And they say, what papers? I said, document the process, but only like two or three people write it down because they don't get it. They don't listen. But that's okay, they listen more after that. But the fact of the matter is, kids like are terrified. I've had kids drop the class when they knew they were gonna have to sit down and eat with a stranger. Because we're so habitual. People sit in the same seats all the time. You know, just the fact that I asked you to change your seat made you uncomfortable right away. You say, who the hell is he to tell me where? I want to sit in back. You know, and it's so much fun because when I shake hands, I shook hands with him earlier, I kept my calm down, right? And it was so weird, wasn't it? You grab someone's wrist. I do that because it gets people to think. Original thought. It's not habitual. Although it backfired once, I was at a wood show and my buddy introduced me to this very well-known cabinet maker. And I said, I'm so glad to meet you. And I put my thumb down and he said, me too. And I said, oh yeah? And I looked down and he had run his hand over a table saw and literally they took out his middle finger and sewed his hand back. So he only had four fingers. I wanted to ask him how he drove in Boston. But I kept my hand in my pocket for a whole day because I didn't want to, you know, embarrass him. But I think about the blocks to creativity, and one of them is habit. And if this is hard, just change it. I know how hard it is to change as much as I want students to change. I want bombs to go off in your head. I want you to stop being complacent, you know, sit in the front in every class. Because the people who sit in front get noticed, and the people who sit in back get noticed by professors. I don't cast aspersions on them, but I wonder why they're so reticent to move forward. Come to the top. You know, my daughter had a baby the other day, I went to Beth Israel, and I met the receptionist. I was parked in one garage, and I hadn't been there for a while, and I wasn't sure where her unit was, and my God, this woman was, so, I wanted to take her home with me, and she was so great. I said, you should be running the hospital. She was an expert at public relations. She really cared for people. And time and time again, I've been to Staples four times in the last week, because they've given me wrong stuff. I showed them what I needed, explained it, this'll work for you. No, if you read the directions, it doesn't work. I had a card reader for my camera, and when I got the card reader home, it said, absolutely do not place this kind of battery in the card reader. And when I brought it back to explain it to the manager, I said, this doesn't work. He rolled his eyes and he sighed. He's a manager of a store. You don't do that to a customer. So I said, oh, look at you. You're rolling your eyes and you're sighing. Am I an inconvenience to you? And he said, well, let me see if I can help. And then he started taking the card from my, and trying to, he was going to jam it into the machine. It said it'll destroy all the pictures. I get pictures of my grandchildren here. Don't mess with my pictures. I almost hit him. And I said, stop. And he wouldn't stop. I finally literally had to grab his hand and say, stop, you are going to ruin the pictures. And he said, what's the matter with you? I said, nothing. Look at the directions. It says, do not put this. It was a picture of it. It'll ruin the piece and the pictures. And he said, oh my God, I didn't know that. So I slapped him. No, I didn't. But we need to practice speaking up. Bystander behavior is nowhere worth it. I mean, that's why the Archdiocese of Boston got into so much trouble, because people just stood back and watched children abused. And didn't say anything. Loads of people knew. And every one of you in this room has seen someone bullied and didn't speak up. And some of you bullied people. You gotta deal with that. You gotta deal with that. We all make mistakes. Take that and turn that into something powerful. It sounds preachy, doesn't it? I'm sorry. Oh, I'm going to get back to you now. What I liked, the first thing I liked was that you asked the first question and you spoke and you weren't afraid. And I liked that comfortable assertiveness. You're like one of the people I would pick if I had to pick out a few people to work with me. Already, this is working, see? But I also liked the fact that she did not raise her hand. Did you notice that? Probably not. She just spoke up. How rude. Not. Here's what, I work with 75 different Indian nations, First People around the country for 3 years. Unbelievable. I'm 103-year-old Navajo. He's knowing stuff that you just really can't even imagine. And so I was invited to talking circles, lucky enough. I was the only, they call us Europeans, you know. They don't call you a white person, you're a European. And so I was lucky enough to be invited to these talking circles where tribal leaders share their very incredible stories, their Genesis story, first man, first woman, or Spider-Man and Spider-Woman. Now, this isn't Spidey, the web-crawling weirdo that you guys grew up with. This is like first people. This is what Indians and Jews and Christians are about, the only people who have a story of Genesis that starts with a man and a woman. Other cultures don't have a beginning. So we kind of have a creation theology about us, Indians and Judeo-Christian thought, that makes us a little different than Eastern culture. And I think that it's interesting to ponder that. But when I've been at meetings with Indians where a white person, a European, will raise their hand, and one woman will nudge the guy next to him, and she'll say, to her, and she'll say, isn't that just like a white person? Isn't that just like a European? Because they don't teach their kids to raise their hands. That's about control. And the fact of the matter is, if you respect people, you don't need to raise your hand. You got that word across, and we interacted, and you didn't have to raise your hand, and it wasn't disrespectful for anyone. And you try this when you're at the Merritt station and your car doesn't work. You're trying to get gasoline. Stand there and just raise your hand and see what happens. It's so bizarre. Why do we think we need to control children? And that's the part of the beginning of that process. You will raise your hand and be polite. And there's nothing wrong with being polite. There's nothing wrong with considering people's feelings and not being rude. What is the subtle things that we do in our society that push people down, that's a problem. When we do things habitually and we don't think, why do you say God bless you? I didn't sneeze, but thank you. Why do you say God bless you? Do you know why you say that?
Because you stop breathing.
Okay, we have Italians and Irish people here, all right? And some say your heart goes out the window and you know, it leaves your body. And that, I forget, that's like, I can't remember which is Irish and which is Italian, but what was the other thing? Your heart stops. Are you Italian?
Irish.
Okay, that's what the Irish said. That's where you got that. But here's where that came from. 1348, the Black Plague, the Black Death. And the brewmeisters in Munich went to the monks and said, hey, you got to cut a deal for us here, you know, because the Black Plague is killing everyone, and you know God, can you work a deal with us? And they said, sure, cost you, but you can pay indulgences. And also, you have to dance in the coldest day of the year in the Marktplatz for the rest of eternity. Seven guys. Those breweries are still there. You've drunk Löwenbräu, Teufelsbräu. Yeah, and I lived in Bavaria for a year, and it was amazing to actually, on the 21st of January, watch them roll out the barrel, where that song came from. They roll out the barrel, they hoist the oldest brewmeister up, and then they all dance around the circle, and they do that every year since 1348. And you know what? The Black Plague did not hit Munich. And that's why Germans say Gesundheit, which means health. And that's why some Italians and some Spanish say salute. It means health. In those areas where they say that, in fact, the Black Plague didn't hit. But where it did hit, they started saying God bless you and they never stopped. And that is the Dark Ages equivalent of kiss your ass goodbye. Because if someone sneezed, you wouldn't let them in the house. You'd say God bless you and you'd close the door. And we're on the verge of, so far, knock on wood, the epidemic hasn't hit. But I heard just today that the death rate is going up precipitously, even though many of you haven't gotten your flu shot. My dad was 90, I gotta look at the time, it's getting late, I know. My dad, who was 94, recently showed me a picture, which I've never seen, of my great grandmother, his grandmother, who lived in Sweden, and she'd sent a postcard with her picture in 1918 sitting on the bed of her youngest son. She had 10 boys. She could have had a baseball team with a manager. And two of them moved to America, and 8 of them were living there. And she was sitting on the bed in the hospital with her youngest son, who was sitting up, strapping, handsome young man, and within 1 week, by the time that postcard got here, the whole family had been wiped out. She and her 8 sons were all dead from the Spanish flu. And we're very blasé about things. We think that the lights are going to stay on, and we think that our cell phones are going to continue working. And one of my former students, he and his fiance, asked if I would do their wedding ceremony up in Walpole, Maine this summer, on Kemmerwood Point. And I get up there and went to call Ryan, and my cell phone didn't work because there's no reception on Kemmerwood Point. And you're shaking your head, yes, you know this, right? And I'm hard of hearing, so I read lips and look at faces. Don't freak out. It's okay. But the fact of the matter is, we are very complacent about our lives. And I've got a jackknife in my pocket. I could walk into the woods today, and I'd be fine. Be hard, but I know how to. I'm not saying I'm some crazy psychotic survivalist, but I also have been a farmer all my life, and I know about life and death, and I know how to take care of myself. And the fact of the matter is, we are really getting soft, and we've got to be creative. We've got to think differently. I stopped at the gas station on Blue Hill Avenue and Morton Street. I worked at the Riverside Nursing Home for years. I worked as a consultant there. One of the only white people in the building. The administrator was white, and I was white, and everybody else. Most of the staff were Afro-American, Haitian, I should say. And most of the patients were Afro-American. And it was one of the best nursing homes I've ever worked in. That we had no private pay patients. Mr. Kelly got $39 a day for Medicaid, for caring for those people, and for 3 years I worked there, we never got a deficiency from the Department of Public Health. It was one of the best homes I've ever worked with. And I'm not uncomfortable in any neighborhood. And on the way back from, my dad was with me visiting my daughter, and at the hospital, saw my new grandchild, watched my dad hold his second great grandchild, which he never thought he'd live, with his family history, never thought he'd live even to see grandchildren. And I was low on gas, stopped at the Merit station. I took out my wallet, and I took out my credit card, and I put it in the machine, and I put there was only one bay open, all cars in every bay. And it was a beautiful Sunday, nice sunny day. Put my gas nozzle in, and I felt like I wasn't alone, you know, you get that feeling. And I turned around, and this great big dude standing behind me, and he looked right in my face, and he said, "Mister, I need money." And I've got my wallet in my hand, right in his face, and I've got the credit card here, and I took the credit card out. I bought about 75%, three quarters of a gallon of gas, that's all I bought. I just wasn't thinking about how much gas I needed then. And I took out my credit card, put my wallet in, and I looked at him and I said, "See that guy in the front seat? He's almost 94 years old. He's my dad. We lost my mom, which we had 3 years before." I didn't tell him that. And I said, "We're just coming back from Beth Israel Hospital," which was absolutely true. I don't lie. And he looked at me and he said, "I'm sorry, mister." I said, "I can't help you. I can't even talk. And I can't help you. I hope you understand." And he said, "I'm sorry, mister." And I immediately walked around slowly, got in the car. As I was getting in the car, I heard the man in the next bay screaming, swearing at the top of his lungs as this man ran down the street with his wallet. He robbed him instead. Thank God I taught creative process for several years. And thank God I'm not opposed to treating people like human beings. I was an adolescent psychologist, and I actually worked at Bristol Acres School in Taunton, which was a wonderful treatment center. I left my job at the state hospital in 1969. They opened this school, it was great, 30 really tough kids, a wonderful staff, and a month after I got the job, just before we were married, we had just bought the farm here in Bridgewater, and the Department of Education, because it was times like this, cut all of the private treatment centers, sent all the kids back to prison, to jail. They're all dead now. We've kept track of all 30 kids are dead, either drug overdose or murder. It's awful. So it was a terrible tragedy to have to close the school. I wrote psychological reports on all these kids and ended up, I left the night, first they had, in the afternoon, the last day, they had this wonderful Chinese dinner that they had made for us. I didn't know how they did it, none of us did. And they said, you served us, we want to serve you. So please, we don't have enough food for everybody but eat. And we did, and it was wonderful. And I said goodbye. I felt like I'd given birth to a black hole. I felt so empty. And I went back, I lost my job. This wonderful school was closed. I didn't know what we were gonna do. And I went back to the hospital and I asked for my job back. They said, the only job we have left is the occupational therapy department, and you have to work with old people. We've moved all the old folks. And I'm an adolescent psychologist. I almost puked. And I unlocked the door and I walked onto the ward, and there's this old black woman lying in the bed. Oh my God, she had like jet black eyes and this kinky white hair, and you could see the origin and insertion of every muscle. And I walked up and I said, good morning, my name's Warren. And she looked up at me and she said, my name's Mary Evans and I don't steal. And I said, well, Mary, I don't steal either, let's talk. And I took my chair and I pulled it up. We talked for about 20 minutes. I met a few other people that changed my life that day too. And from that moment on, I was a gerontologist. I was no longer, and an OT. I was no longer a psychologist, an adolescent psychologist. Because when I got up to the nursing station and I read her chart, Mary Evans was 107 years old. She was a slave, born before the Civil War. I mean, do the math. And I will never be the same person. And I will never, when I look at a person of color, I braille that invisible gold chain. And I think about the stories Mary told me and how they put a sheet over her in the day room. She'd go, whoop, 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 whoop. I loved her. And one day, and she'd fall asleep, was like someone had draped a sheet over a piece of furniture when you go on vacation. And one day the nurse lifted up the sheet and Mary's, she booped her way off to wherever she is now, including that gold chain. But I'll never be the same person, which is one of the reasons I was so comfortable working at Riverside Nursing Home. And comfortable with this. It was just another experience at the gas station. There's one thought I didn't get back to when I mentioned, oh, the school. Yeah, I have to tell you what happened with that. 10 years later, we went to a reunion, Michelle and I, we went to a reunion with the Bristol Acres staff. I hadn't seen any of these people for years. Every so often I bump into them, but they're still, one of the guys who runs the Department of Retardation for the Department of Mental Health to this day, Larry Thibodeau, he's from Middleborough. Louis Nissenbaum is an extremely well-known social worker down in New Bedford. Some of you may have run into these people. They're real people and they are amazing. And we had this reunion and everybody was reminiscing about Bristol Acres School and how the great experiences we had, how lucky we were to work together and meet these kids. It was a privilege to be in these kids' space. What they lived through, I can't even imagine. Nothing compared to my friend Michael Pogori, or some of you maybe. But I just always respect people just for the experience they might have. And halfway through the evening though, I said, I'll never forget that meal. By the way, that night, the kids burned the house to the ground. It was a gorgeous Chimney Colonial, and they burned the house to the ground. And I wasn't there, though. I wasn't residential staff. So halfway through the evening, I said, I'll never forget that Chinese meal. I can't believe how they pulled that together. That was like so amazing. And you could hear a pin drop in the room. And Chief looked over to Louis, and he said, oh my God, Warren doesn't know. He wasn't residential staff. He wasn't there when they burned the house down. And I said, what are you guys talking about? And Louis looked over and he said, Warren, we ate Heidi. Heidi was our Cocker Spaniel mascot and disappeared 3 days before the school closed. And the kids killed the dog and cut it up and fed it to us. Now, I may be wrong. I never really finally got my master's or a PhD in psychology, but I think, and I may be wrong, it was a symbolic gesture that they were a little angry, I'm probably the only person in this room that's eaten a Cocker Spaniel. It was a little like chicken. When I see people walking Cocker Spaniels, I want to say, they're delicious. But I don't. The fact of the matter is, you don't know. Can you imagine what these kids had to have endured in their lives, their little young lives, to do something that hard and that horrible? And I still, to this day, say it was a privilege to be in these kids' face. And I'm sorry I didn't have the tools then that I have now. I still don't have enough tools. I'm still just a fly speck. But my wish for you, none of this is about me. It's about you. My concern is that you folks get rid of habit. Don't be as polite as you've been. And be kind, but be comfortably assertive, like you. And it's beautiful. It works. And change the world. One of my students at senior year said, I don't know what to do for a project. I have people do, they have to write an 80-page book and bind it themselves and do a whole project during the class and do other assignments. Like take themselves on a date for 2 hours every week. And they can't, they have to send me an invitation. So, and they can't bring a guest. And just to fill the well, so that, because they won't burn out then. Greg Ranieri, amazing guy, accounting major. He told me he was gonna be at the grotto praying at 9:30 at night on a Saturday night. From 9:30 to 11:30, he was going to be praying in the grotto, captain of the football team senior year, the day of his last football game, his football career is over, and I'm thinking, there's no way in hell Greg Ranieri, he's going to be out partying because they won the game. I listened to WSHL, they won the game. I get in my car because I trust but verify, and I get in my car and drove over to Stonehill, and there was Greg Ranieri with a lit candle at 10:30 at night, all alone praying. How would you like him for an accountant? If we had people like that at Enron, wouldn't that be great? And so, it's this one guy, Sean Kane, took this class, didn't know what to do, and I said, do what you love, Sean. What do you love? He said, I love Suzanne. I said, fine, but you can't, that's way out. And he did, and they're still together. And I was the best man at their wedding, and I was the godfather who was their first child. And he said, what do you love? He said, I love cars. I love Saabs. I love Volvos. And he decided he wanted to work with cars. His parents almost killed him. So they paid for his education. They said, now he's a mechanic. Sean Kane's been on TV every night this week. And last night, Susan Warnock said, Sean Kane has been called for a congressional hearing to testify on Tuesday because he has done the whole Toyota investigation. In that introduction, talked about changing the world. I can't change the world, but you can. I know you can. I've had students who, Kara Cechia was the charge nurse at St. Vincent's Hospital when the buildings went down. And God, she was as tough as nails. Her mother died when she was 11. And she went through Stonehill, and I can't tell you how much I loved her. When I told her to write a letter, or I told all the kids to write about their artist monster, the person who said, you never do this. You'll never be able to make it. Screw them. Write a letter, a one-page letter. Don't send it. And she said, dear Sister Mary Agnes, I'm glad I got you fired, you penguin from hell. Right away, I knew it was Carol. And she said, my mother was dying in the hospital. My father had the flu. I forgot it was the day of the field trip. I went up to you and I said, please, let me run across the street from the parochial school that you went to, and because I forgot it was the field trip. And instead, the nun pulled her up the front of the room and said, this is why Carol will never amount to anything, because she doesn't even know what clothes to wear. She did get the nun fired at 11 years old, which is great. It was fun. She was also the charge nurse at St. Vincent's Hospital in the emergency room that day when those buildings went down. And I can't tell you how that made me. It still makes me feel so good to know someone with her ability was there. Take what you have, grind it up, and turn it into power. And be creative and just have fun. And thank you so much for being here.